Welcome to Conversations with Ryland Fisher. Today we're talking to Archbishop Njongonkulu Ndungane, the former Archbishop of Cape Town. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
So, this year, 2016, and particularly September, it's a very important year and a very important month for you. Can you perhaps tell us why?
Well, in the first place, in September, that's when I was consecrated bishop. It was on the 8th of September in 1991.
So that would be 25 years ago?
25 years since I was made bishop. And then on the 1st of September in 1996, I officially became Archbishop of Cape Town following an electoral process.
Mm. And that was the position you held for 10 years?
I held that position for 11 years, actually.
11 years.
It was 1996 to 2007.
Okay.
And then I was enthroned as Archbishop on the 14th of September. So that makes September very, very special for me.
And this year particularly, I believe you turned 75 this year also?
I turned 75.
You don't look like 75, but...
Yes, and... I now am truly a senior citizen. And of course, it's also the 50th anniversary of my release from Robben Island, which was on the 19th of August in 1966.
Okay. And sadly, I believe it's also, this year was 30 years since
my first wife passed away.
Okay. When was that?
That was in February of 1986, I think.
Yeah. So maybe let's go back a bit. I mean, before you ended up in Robben Island, you grew up in Griqualand West.
I'm a Griqua, I see.
Yeah.
As Trevor Manuel tries to remind me. I was born in Cockstead.
Okay.
And I grew up in Cockstead up till I was 18. And then my father was transferred to Cape Town, to Langa.
Okay.
And we came to Langa.
And so your father was also a priest?
Yes.
Okay. And so how did you get involved in struggle? I mean, how did you end up on Robben Island?
Well, actually, it's a long story. Because as a young boy growing up in Langa, what we normally did on Sunday afternoons is to go and play soccer. And we happened to have been a little bit early for the game of soccer. And there was a crowd that had gathered around Bunga Square, which is where politicians usually came to speak. And we were told that it's Robert Mangalisa Sobukwe who's around and he has come to launch the campaign for the abolition of pastorals. And so we went to listen to Sobukwe.
And he was, of course, for people who don't know, he was the leader of the Pan-Africanist Congress.
The leader of the Pan-Africanist Congress. And we went to listen to him. And he had a focused strategy and a focused campaign in terms of the abolition of passes. His view was that if all the men went and submitted themselves to police stations, not only would the police stations be overflowing, but that there would be no one going out to work. And so it will cripple the... industry, and there will be attention given to this. I think that what attracted me to Sobukwe is his charisma and the fact that he had a campaign that was focused, which was at the heart of the black man. And I can remember his words when he said that this is an evil system which has brought horror and suffering to many men, And then this is now going to be introduced to women. And he said, I cannot imagine that my sister, my wife, my daughter, my mother would be subjected to such a harsh treatment as women. And we've got to say no to this. And I think that and the way he was expressing it, I mean, he was fluent in Xhosa, fluent in English. And then he would then say, let me interpret to Africans for the sake of the security police so that they get exactly what I'm saying. So we got captured by Sobukwe, by his rhetoric, by his oomph, by his zeal.
So what year was this?
That was 1960, beginning of 1960. Must have been about end of January, beginning of February. And he was saying that we are launching on the 21st of March the campaign to abolish the pastors. And so we forgot about soccer, and we got hooked.
And how old were you, and what standard were you?
I was at UCT, starting my studies at UCT. And that meant, of course, that we got hooked up and got canvassing for the abolition of the past laws. And I participated in my very first march to the city, where 30,000 people marched to the city. I think it was towards the end of March, I think.
And so how did it end up that you got arrested?
Well, one, you see, became an activist. And conscientizing people in Langa, and then of course the long arm of the law catches up with you.
And so you were sentenced for, was it further in the aims of a banned organization?
Further in the aims of a banned organization.
And 5 years?
3 years.
3 years.
In Stellenbosch.
Okay.
And
so you were you arrested in Stellenbosch, or were you sentenced?
No.
You were sentenced.
I was arrested in London.
Okay.
But what was happening is that we were farmed to various courts and various to various police stations. And the idea was to make it difficult for people who support us to go to know where exactly we were. So we got sentenced there and left in chains, in handcuffs and leg irons.
Yeah, and so you ended up on Robben Island. But before, what were you studying at UCT?
I was studying BCom Law. I wanted to have big bucks, you see. That was the motive. And of course, my studies suffered through the activism that one got involved in.
And so I believe it was while you were on Robben Island that you kind of, the seeds of going into the priesthood were planted.
Yes, I think that the sense is that I grew up in a home, a Christian home, and parents. My father was a priest, so was my grandfather. And so there was that kind of home environment. But I had vowed that I never wanted to be a priest because I saw how priests were struggling.
They weren't making big bucks.
Huh?
They weren't making big bucks.
They were not making big bucks. That's why I wanted big bucks. And then I ended up on Robben Island. Robben Island, which was hell on earth, actually. And I think the whole idea was to make us want to regret what we had been doing. And of course, we knew that there is no people on earth who was were bent on freedom who came back empty-handed. And so to be in that atmosphere of Robben Island, I think at one stage it was the board registered that we were 1,400 and something, plus one, and the plus one was Sobukwe, who had finished his sentence but was kept on Robben Island. To know that we were in the company of the greats, the Mandelas, the Sobukwes, and all our leaders, sort of gave us comfort as young boys in that atmosphere.
Yeah. And so tell me about you went to then study to become a priest. Sorry. And within a few years, you were ordained as a priest, 42 years ago.
Yes. But I think, first of all, I think that before the decision to go for priesthood, I think I wrestled with God.
Okay.
I wrestled with God, saying that how can a good God who has created the world so beautiful, I mean, when you're on Robben Island, look at Table Mountain, you have got all those kind of questions. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, suddenly there was a moment where one sort of stopped questioning and sort of had inner peace, as if God had touched me to say, I want to use you in the ministry of reconciliation.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was a moment where I had that kind of decision that I need to think about ordination. And of course, we had such good company on Robben Island. People had come there. I always like to tell this story, which I told to Neville Alexander. When Neville Alexander and his team came to Robben Island, what normally happened was this, that the security police would tell the officials on Robben Island that this is a very after-heart group that's coming, and there is that Neville Alexander who's the leader. So when Neville's group came with Figile Bam and all those guys, the waters were saying, Varastari Neville Alexander, you see. And Neville, you know, short, he just comes out. And the waters look at him and says, J. Lich, J. S. Neen. And then there was one big guy, I forget who it was amongst the group, and they say, J. S. Neville Alexander. And so he was taken to the cells where the Mandelas were.
Was it Neville or the big guy?
The big guy. and then Neville stayed with us. And we had political education for a whole month until the security police came to check on the prisoners that were in the isolation cells. I discovered that Neville was with us, not with the Mandelas.
Yeah.
And so we said, we'd come, been arrested for politics, we better learn, be educated. So that's how we spent our days there, being educated by sitting at the feet of the likes of Neville, Alexander, and others.
And so the priesthood?
Yes, I came out and I had two years of banning orders, being restricted to the magisterial districts of Weinberg and Cape Town. And that was a two-year banning order. And I thought that was just an emotional thing that happened on Robben Island, but it kept coming. And of course, I had to go and see my priest, who happens to be my father, to say that I had this feeling and this calling. So he took me to Robert Selby Taylor. And when I walked into Robert Selby Taylor's study, he said, "I've been waiting for you." And so without any hesitation, he decided to send me to Theological College, which was the Federal Theological Seminary in Alice, next to Fort Hare.
Okay. And then becoming bishop, where were you, where did you become a bishop, in which area?
I was elected Bishop of Kimberley and Kuruman by the bishops. It must have been around 1991.
Okay.
After a long period, you know, from seminary, I was placed in Athlone. And I was the first person with this kind of color to minister to people or residents of Athlone, which was quite a challenge in itself. And the laws of the day didn't allow people like me to reside in Athlone, let alone minister to people other than black Africans. And of course, I stayed in there because I believe that the church, God is greater than what the apartheid government is saying. And so I had my time in Athlone. And there's that nice story, which I think was picked up by some journalists. When I used to visit, I used to be sometimes in service. So I knocked at the front door of his home, and the child came to the door and shouted, "Mother, Mommy, the milkman is at the door," you see. And when I became Archbishop, somebody, I think it must have been the Arcus, or the big headline, "Milkman of Athlone becomes Archbishop." Yes, so from Athlone, I went to King's College in London, where I did further studies in theology, working in various parishes, coming back and worked in Elsie's River, and then got into the administration of the church in Archbishop Philip Russell's time as Archbishop. I had a stint as principal of one of our theological colleges at St. Bede's. And then when Desmond became Archbishop, he invited me to be his executive officer. And it was from that position that I was elected Bishop of Kimberley and Kuruman. A very huge diocese, stretching from DR to Upington and taking the whole of Kuruman. So it was quite a challenge in the ministry.
And so 5 years later you became Archbishop.
Yes. 5 years later, there was a vacancy in Cape Town. Desmond retired, and then there was a vacancy in Cape Town, and there was an article by Michael Morris. Apparently, Michael Morris had read something I'd said in 1981 when I was working as a public relations officer with the church under Philip Russell, where I said that the church need to prepare for a time when apartheid is no more. And so Michael Morris was saying, there's the man who should be elected as Archbishop. He had this foresight that apartheid would go, and therefore that's the man. And needless to say that a lot of people threw a lot of bricks on me, said, "I'm dreaming." I said, "We're working for the abolition of apartheid. Ooh. It will come one day." So I got elected as Archbishop.
But when you were elected the Pope, it was gone already. When he became Archbishop.
'96, yes. Yes.
Yeah.
It was that. And then, of course, coming to Bishop's Court with Archbishop Tutu, and I was cartooned that with its head up to my eyes, you see. And I recall
to indicate that you've got big boots to fill, to indicate that you had big boots to fill.
That's it.
Yeah.
And ironically, when the phone rang, wanted to speak to the Archbishop of Cape Town, I said, wait a minute, I'll go and look for him. Because, you see, I worked there and Desmond was Archbishop. So it took some time to get to know that I'm actually in that office.
Yeah. But was it intimidating following up in the footsteps of somebody like Desmond Tutu?
Well, not really. I think that I've always taken the view that the God who calls is the God who equips. And God raises people with different gifts for different times. I think Desmond did a sterling job as Archbishop. And he had those kinds of gifts and charisma to drive that agenda. And I took it that I'm not going to be I'm Njongonkulu Ndungane, not Desmond Tutu. Whilst you appreciate all what Archbishop Tutu has done, God will determine what the new course of ministers needed using the gifts that I have in pushing things forward. And of course, it so happened that there was that whole question of international debt, Jubilee 2000. I got thrown in as the patron of Jubilee 2000, and which had significance in terms of the abolition of debt to developing countries, and it was quite a huge mobilization in getting that agenda on the G8 to talk about. And I remember that part of our strategies was forming a human chain in Birmingham when the G8 was meeting. And Tony Blair had to come out and listen to what people were saying. So the issue of poverty and the eradication of poverty became a major issue during my time. And I was part of that coalition with Sangoko in terms of the national poverty hearings in our country to bring those issues on the table.
And that, of course, has still been part of the work that you do.
Yes.
And so maybe, so when you stopped being Archbishop in, what was it, 2007? What did you do with yourself?
Well, two things, really. I think the first was the establishment of the African Monitor. The African Monitor is an organization which has to do with development in the continent. You'll recall that the three presidents, Thabo Mbeki, Obasanjo, and I think, what's this other country now, where Ben Bella came from? Yeah, but three presidents championed the idea of a development agenda crafted by Africans, which they presented to the G8 or the G7 as it then was, where the African governments committed themselves to development, and the G7/G8 committed themselves to making funds available for development in the continent.
Mm.
And there was a big drive towards that. And it's interesting how the idea of the African Monitor came about. I was in a taxi, in a cab in London, and the cab driver says, you must be from Africa. I said, yes. Do you agree with me, he says, that Tony Blair is mad? I said, why? Taking all our money and give it to those corrupt governments of Africa. I didn't answer him, but I said, that man needs to be answered. And sipping a beer on a restaurant over the Thames with a friend, I said, you know, I've been challenged by a taxi driver, and I think that I want to canvass that we establish a mechanism that's going to monitor the funds that the developed nations give and what African governments do with that. And after consulting with various formations in the continent, civil society organizations and religious bodies, we came up with the idea that we establish African Monitor to monitor the development agenda in the continent. So that is one thing that I did. And the second one was...
And are you still involved with it?
Not very much directly, but I'm still a chair of the board.
Okay.
But not in a kind of a full-time position as I was in the first 4 or 5 years of my retirement. I am a kind of an elder statesman there now. Now and again, I'm utilized for instance, when we were doing the post-MDG agenda, which came to the Sustainable Development Goals, I did a lot of footwork in the continent, knocking at doors, and we finally, as civil society, got our agenda, which we fed into the processes that came up with the Sustainable Development Goals. So that's the one thing that I did in my since my retirement. The second one is the restoration of historic schools. It was actually Barbara Jordan, as Minister of Arts and Culture, on behalf of the national government, who came to me and says that, can I champion the cause of the restoration of historic schools and restore them to be centers of education and cultural excellence. And these are the schools, you'll remember, which produced leaders of integrity and caliber in our country, where almost everybody who's anybody in the country, amongst Black Africans, went to those schools.
So we're talking Lovedale?
Yes, Lovedale, Hilltown, St. Matthews, Adams, Lemana. There are about 50 such schools in the country. And so we began that task of working amongst the schools. Tiger Tooth is one example, which is doing very well. So I've been involved in that. Even with that kind of work, now that I'm 75, I'm considering that at least I should step down and maybe get a younger person to drive the agenda and sort of be an elder statesman cheering from the sidelines.
Yeah. So all of these important events culminating in this year, this month, how are we celebrating it?
Well, we began last Sunday, we went to Langa. I went to Langa to take part in these church services there. And as I indicated, that Langa parish and Cyprians is like a whole parish to me, because that's the first parish that I worshipped in my adult life, and my father was parish priest there. So we had a good fellowship with the people of Langa. And then on Thursday next week, we are going to Robben Island.
That will be the 22nd.
22nd, yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We have a program that we want to launch, which we call it Intergenerational Dialogue Series. What we are hoping to do is to get people who have been involved in the liberation movement and young people of today to enter into some dialogue in terms of moving the agenda forward. And we think that it's timely with all the happenings amongst the students. The roads must fall, the fees must fall, that we need to have a platform for dialogue as South Africans in terms of where are we with our democracy, what are the things that we need to do to deepen our democracy. And so we have this series that we are launching in partnership with Robben Island, and we're having students from UCT, and there will be students from UWC and Stellenbosch. And the organizers are telling me that they have got student leaders also from across the country, and youth leaders, together with some seniors like myself, to engage with the young people. There's so much that's good in our country, and there's so much that can go bad, go wrong in our country, and we want to be alongside with young people. They're the majority. Sorry, we've got a huge number of young people in our country, and most of them, some of them are not employed, and so on and so forth. So those are the issues that we want to push forward on the agenda and enter this dialogue. And we hope that this will be an annual event, and Robben Island thinks that September is a good month to have this event, because it's our Heritage Month. So we're looking forward to the launch of this, and we hope it will be a success. So that's the one thing. Then we have got a celebratory service in Stellenbosch, where we'll be giving thanks for all that has been, and for all that is, and for all that will be. And of course, it will culminate with a service in Umtata Cathedral, because most of my family are there, and my father and mother are lying. Their graves are in Kanduli. So in the tradition of our fathers, we've got to do something around where our parents are. So we will do that.
And so when will that be?
16th of December.
Okay.
We'll have a service in the cathedral.
Okay.
There is, of course, a traditional slaughtering and all those kind of things. There'll be a lot of meat. You're welcome to come and it will be a joyous occasion.
Yeah. So maybe let's go a little bit to the state of our country. I mean, as Archbishop, you obviously, and whether you, you know, in that position, or whether you, the former Archbishop, you obviously pay a lot of interest as to what's happening in our country, what's happening with our democracy.
Mm-hmm.
Are you happy? Are you sad? Are you disappointed?
I don't know how to respond to that. I think that I can say that the great thing is that we are a constitutional democracy and that we have got a constitution which is actually a great constitution. And that gives us hope for the future. Secondly, we have got institutions in our country that actually are sort of set up to be the guardians of the constitution, that we don't deviate. I mean, the public protector is one, and Tulema Donson has done a wonderful job in what she has been doing. Then we've got the judiciary, which has been very good in making sure that the rule of law is maintained. And above all, we have a vigilant press, and excellent journalists who are able to put things in front of the eyes of the people, and a very vibrant civil society. And I think that those are the plus signs. And then, of course, the downside is what is happening in the leadership of the ANC as it is presently constituted. I think Cyril Ramaphosa says that a government that is at war with itself, although the president denies that. And I think that it's very sad when the Constitutional Court rules that the president has violated his oath of office. And quite a lot of people, even within the ANC, have been saying that he should be stepping down because he is leading the country in a wrong direction. I think there's a chorus that's rising to a crescendo which says that, because it's creating a lot of confusion.
Mm. And do you support that call?
Of course I do, because we are at risk in terms of the capture of the state. What is happening in the state enterprises, it's not good. What is happening in terms of the treasury, Pravin Gordhan, a kind of a war against Pravin Gordhan, because he's refusing to surrender the keys of the treasury, and corruption has just derailed us as a country. And I think that those are the issues that need to be addressed. And I think that the African National Congress is an organization that has got a lot of good people within it, and we think that if they sit back and get proper people to guide and direct the country, we can move away from the precipice.
Mm.
And you hear today, this thing about fees must fall. The thing about education should have been addressed long ago. I think it was in 1998, I think following the National Poverty Hearings, where I made a call for a Marshall Plan on education and the funding of universities. Had we attended to that then, we wouldn't be in this problem. And you recall that at that time, we were against the arms deal, and we put a lot of resources in the arms deal, those toys that are there, and Pumsi Lamlamo Nuka, said, you know, God has got a wicked sense of humor. You stood against this armstill, but you sit in your stoop and you watch this toys being paraded. And also, we said that we are under no obligation to honor the odious date of apartheid. those resources could have been put together in terms of education. Today we talk about going nuclear, which is we're talking trillions, and then we talk about buying the president a new toy for him to be moving around the world. So it's a question of priorities in the use of resources that will help move us forward. So we are very concerned about education in our country and about the universities in particular. And I think that if we are not careful, you know, the apartheid regime closed those secondary schools in 1956, which I'm trying to resuscitate. And if we are not careful, there are some amber lights in terms of tertiary education, in particular our universities, because the government has decreased its contribution to universities over the years, whilst it's asking universities to increase the number of students. And of course, that leads to the increase in fees so as to balance books. Mm-hmm. And so it's a matter that needs addressing. Because if we are not doing so, the academics or professors who have got high qualifications can go anywhere in the world and get employed. And the children of the middle class will go to universities elsewhere. And it's the poor that will remain in hollow shells. And if we're not doing anything in terms of addressing what the students are saying, in 10 years' time, we'll have to ask ourselves, where will our universities be? And if you remember what happened in our continent, we had outstanding universities when independence came, like Makerere, Ibadan, Ghana, for instance. I had said to myself, when I graduated at Cape Town University, I will go to Makerere for an M and go to Ghana for a doctorate. And so there was quite a wide choice, but those institutions have declined as the dictators took over. So if we're not careful, we might walk that road, but I hope reason and common sense will prevail, and that for the sake of our children and our children's children, that the quality of our institutions will remain. But it means there's got to be an injection of capital and funds from the national government, and that business and government could put a pact together and have something to put on the table. I know that Max Price argues that the rich people must pay for universities. That's another story, but I think that as far as I'm concerned, there needs to be an injection of capital so that the poorest of the poor have access to education.
So maybe let's go to the church. And one of the contentious issues in the church has been the issue of sexual preferences. We've seen recently the issue of Port Tutu, you know, as a high-profile kind of incident. Mm-hmm. What is your view on it?
Well, I think that the matter has been on our agenda. And sometimes we don't take the right decisions. And sometimes we're nervous to move forward. I was privileged 1998 at the Lambeth Conference to chair a section that dealt with the ethical issues of the day, and human sexuality was one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And we prepared very well for this because we put together a group of bishops, I think some 60 bishops or so, from across the world, who from extremely conservative to radically liberal, under one room to deal with this issue. And we had an excellent paper that was given by Denise Ackerman, An Ethics of Relationships with Living with Difference and Otherness. And for about 2 weeks, there was a ding-dong with this group, among this group, until they said they found each other. And they said that we agree on these issues, we don't agree on these. There's so much work that still must be done. And we don't want to have a resolution placed at Lambeth, but we want this report to go down to the dioceses and parishes for discussion, and we come back next session of provincial of Lambeth to deal with the resolution. Unfortunately, the then Archbishop of Canterbury wanted a resolution, and which was debated in a full house over 1.5 hours in the full view of the media. It was a disastrous debate. And I always say that anybody who's a chair of a meeting should know that you can't put a contentious issue in a full house like that without, with people who have not done that, don't work that those 60 bishops did. And I believe that if we had followed the route that we recommended, that they let the substance of the report be discussed in the wider church, would be far in coming closer to this. And I think that what, of course, part of that report was talk about the need for pastoral guidance and acceptance of people of homosexual orientation. I think that the issue that's in context is the question of marriage, same-sex relationships, because in terms of the law of the church and the rubrics, marriage is interpreted as between a man and a woman. And so there is contention in that until you can change that. But then some of us are open to monogamous, covenanted, same-sex relationships and giving pastoral support to people of homosexual orientation.
Thank you so much, sir. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.